Committee will come to order. I want to thank you for joining us today as we consider the fiscal year 2015 budget request for the Department of the Army. Secretary McHugh, General Odierno, thank you for being here. Our nation is very fortunate to have both of you in your positions at this time. General Abrams, who was the 26th Army Chief of Staff, had a quote in regards to our failure to properly maintain the Army after World War II and the negative consequences that resulted in the early days of the Korean War. And I quote, "We paid dearly for unpreparedness during those early days in Korea with our most precious currency, the lives of our young men. The monuments we raised to their heroism and sacrifice are really surrogates for the monuments we owe ourselves for our blindness to reality, for our indifference to real threats to our security, and our determination to deal in intentions and perceptions, for our unsubstantiated wishful thinking about how war would not come. It seems to me that we're ignoring the lessons of history. Based on what we know about this budget, the continued impacts of sequestration, and General Odierno's testimony during the Strategic Choices Management Review hearing last fall, the Army is being forced down a path where it will be unable to fulfill its Title 10 requirements. General Odierno has already told us that the Army can meet the nation's defense strategy with an Army comprised of 450,000 active, 335,000 National Guard, and 195,000 reserve forces. But to do so would be a fairly high risk. However, based on sequestration, the Army isn't heading towards those numbers. They're actually heading towards 420,000 active, 315,000 guard, and 185,000 reserve. That's 60,000 less. The defense strategy reaffirmed in the Quadrennial Defense Review assumes that future conflicts will involve limited stability operations, involve minimal casualties, and assume significant troop contributions from our partner countries. Therefore, the department does not have to size the Army for long duration land wars. I worry that the department is justifying its deep cuts to the Army based on this set of unrealistic assumptions. We can look to every major land conflict we've been involved in to know that we're usually wrong. And we've seen how deep cuts to our defense capabilities, especially the Army, can result in dire consequences. I fear that we as a nation are heading down that path that General Abrams was referring to. Wishful thinking is not a strategy to pin our force structure decisions upon. I hope these sobering remarks remind us to not lose sight of our shared values and the vital importance of reversing the dangerous budget trajectory. I look forward to your testimony here today. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Secretary McHugh and General Odierno, for testifying before us today and for your outstanding service to our country. The Chairman correctly lays out the budget challenges that you face, indeed the entire DOD and much of our country faces. It is great that we were able to get a budget agreement at the end of last year that gave us some appropriations numbers and bills for FY14 and FY15. That certainly was an improvement over government shutdowns and continuing resolutions and constant uncertainty, but the challenges are still great. First of all, those numbers for FY15 are very tight. We all must remember that a little over 2 years ago, the Department of Defense came together, looked at the next 10 years and said, you know, what are the challenges that we face? What's a realistic look at what the budget should be? And built a strategy around that budget. That strategy, I believe, had 490,000 contemplated to be within the Army and a whole bunch of other strategy decisions. It was difficult, perhaps not ideal, but it was a strategy that most people in the Department of Defense felt could be implemented. Well, since that time, that strategy has been blown up by further budget cuts, by sequestration, by government shutdowns and all of that, and you've had to scramble again to try to figure that out. And make no mistake about it, everybody on this committee should know that this is not the budget that the President or you would want. You have been forced into it by the size of the budget that has been passed by Congress, both in terms of FY14 and FY15, and then even more dire, what could happen if the 8 years of sequestration that are still on the books actually happen. So the budget you've put together has reflected the numbers that you have been forced to live with. In fact, the president even has gone so far as to send up an additional, I think it's $52 billion or $56 billion in spending that says, this is what I would like to spend, half of that, and was for defense, to show the areas where we would like to be able to spend more money. They put offsets in to cover the cost of that, offsets which I realize Congress probably will not accept, but the challenge remains. Here's the amount of money more we would like to spend. If we on this committee want to spend it, find the offsets. Find the offsets, make it work, and spend that extra money. If you don't, we have to live with the numbers that we have. And there are very few members of this Congress who would say that those numbers are ideal or even workable, but it is what you have to live with. And that's what gets you to the decisions that you have made in this budget. And I believe that the decisions are sound. They're certainly controversial. When you look at what is going on with the Guard and Reserve, that is controversial. Bringing the size of the force down to 440 or 450 is controversial. Many of the changes that you've made in terms of your air support, in terms of the helicopters, are going to be controversial, but they fit within the budget and they make sense within that budget. And as I've said many times in this hearing, I would urge everybody here, if you don't like those cuts, offer alternatives. Offer alternatives or give them more money. The giving them more money part does not seem likely for a variety of different reasons, which I won't get into this morning. But if we're stuck with that cap number, it is not enough for this committee to rail against the cuts that have been proposed in this budget. We have to offer alternatives. It is literally a zero-sum game. And I think the Department of the Army, Department of Defense, have looked long and hard at that and come up with reasonable choices to make that work. And the final thing I'll say about this is what I really believe makes those choices reasonable is, as the chairman alludes to, the worst thing that we can do is ask the men and women serving in our Army to perform a task that we do not equip and train them to do. That is what a hollow force is. And no matter the size of the force, if they are not equipped and trained, they are not ready, and it is a dereliction of our duty to prepare them. So set the size, but make sure they are trained and equipped to perform the tasks that we ask them to do. If we do not accept some of the reasonable cuts that are put in place here, if we insist on higher numbers in all of these places, that gives us the very real possibility of having that hollow force. The force will be bigger. The Guard and Reserve will be bigger. There will be certain pet programs that are important to people that won't be cut. But where will that money be made up? That money will be made up in readiness. That money will be made up in less maintenance, less equipment, and less training. So we will have a larger force that is not prepared to fight. And that is the worst dereliction of duty that we can have. So I would urge us to, you know, live with the budget we've got and make sure that the men and women serving in the Army have the training and equipment that they need to perform whatever tasks it is that we decide that they're going to do. I do not for a moment think that we absolutely have to just totally accept the budget that you're giving us. I'm sure there are places where other savings can be found. It's the duty of this committee to take a look at that and try to find those. And I hope that we will, but the committee is not doing its duty if we just say, don't cut this and don't offer an alternative. So I think this hearing this morning is incredibly important as we sift through those tough choices and try to figure out, are they the correct ones? And if not, in this zero-sum game that we're living in, what are the correct cuts that need to be made? So again, I thank both Secretary McHugh and General Ordierno in general for your fantastic service, but in particular for the extraordinarily difficult set of circumstances that you've had to wrestle with in putting together this budget. I look forward to the testimony and the questions. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Smith, distinguished members of the committee. I deeply appreciate this, now the fifth opportunity I've had to come before this committee as secretary, and as in the past, to discuss with you the truly incredible work of our soldiers, our civilian and leaders this past year, and the current state of America's Army. And equally important, the uncertain and perilous times that should lie ahead should the vital requirements in our budget requests not be approved. I need to be very clear up front. The time for action is now. We must have this budget to properly restructure, to reduce and revamp our force, and quite frankly, we need it to protect your Army as we march in a dangerous and unpredictable future. This year and next may very well decide the fate of the world's greatest combat force and could have implications for both our nations as well as the world's security for many years to come. As this committee knows so full well, the cuts we've endured under the Budget Control Act and sequestration, as have been mentioned already, have damaged significantly our readiness, drastically reduced our modernization programs, and demanded sharp cuts to our end strength. These, coupled with the significant shortfall in the 2013 OCO funding, caused your Army to enter this year with a $3.2 billion hole in readiness alone. Moreover, although the bipartisan budget agreement did indeed provide some temporary relief, we're still implementing a $7.7 billion cut to our fiscal year 14 budget request. And to meet our top line requirements, we've had to cut another $12.7 billion from our 15 submission. In order to protect current operations, our combat power, as well as our soldiers and our families, we've been forced to make extremely hard choices in this budget. Choices that impact every component, affect every camp, post, and station, and limit nearly every modernization and investment program. Trust me, this is not what we wanted. It's not what your Army, I think, deserves. But it's what we have had to do to preserve America's land power in such an austere fiscal environment as constructed by the dictates approved in law. Nevertheless, in spite of turbulent funding and tremendous change, this past year has been one of great transition, transformation, and triumph for your Army, not just here at home, but around the globe as well. The resiliency, agility, and determination of our warriors has been nothing short of amazing. From intense combat to counterterrorism and retrograde to humanitarian relief, disaster assistance, and regional engagement, your soldiers and civilians from every component, active, National Guard, and Reserve, have seen unprecedented success, saved countless lives, promoted freedom and democracy in some 150 nations around the world. In Afghanistan, the Army continued to fight insurgents and terrorists as we transitioned into a training and support role, helping to set conditions for elections in April and an appropriate withdrawal in December. Simultaneously, we continued one of the largest retrograde operations in our nation's history, returning or removing or demilitarizing some 580,000 pieces of equipment in just the past 12 months alone. We plan to retrograde over $10.2 billion of the Army's $15.5 billion in equipment currently there. As we continue to fight in one theater, we also expanded our regional alignments, conducting dozens of engagements with partners around the world. From the rebalance to the Pacific to exercises in Africa, South America, and Europe, our soldiers demonstrated their global responsiveness, reassured our allies, and deterred would-be aggressors. In the Pacific, the Army remained a cornerstone of support with some 80,000 active and reserve soldiers available to conduct operations. We assigned First Corps to PACOM to provide a rapidly deployable joint headquarters, maintained a THAAD battery in Guam to provide theater missile defense, and conducted 28 large-scale exercises with 13 different countries. Elsewhere, we conducted over 70 engagements with partners in Africa, participated in multilateral exercises with NATO, and deployed teams from the Georgia Army National Guard to serve several Central and South American countries. We supported stability in the Middle East with over 4,300 soldiers participating in Operation Spartan Shield, as well as 2,200 taking part in seven exercises, including the deployment of key elements of the 1st Armored Division to Jordan. Simultaneously, as our forces perform vital missions around the world, the Army began a major transformation to reorganize our brigade combat teams, accelerate end strength reductions, and cut our headquarters staff, all designed to protect critical readiness and seek more balance under these budget times. In June, we announced the elimination of 12 brigade combat teams so that we could reorganize and strengthen those that remained. In September, we announced a two-year acceleration of our drawdown to reach 490,000 active, 350,000 Guard, and 202,000 Army Reserve soldiers by the end of 2015, with the vast majority of those cuts being taken from the active forces. In the summer, we conducted a comprehensive review in coordination with DOD and directed the reduction of headquarters personnel by up to 25% across the force. As we continue to retrograde, restructure, and reduce, we also continue our transition to decisive action training, replacing our recent focus on counterinsurgency. Unfortunately, due to severe cuts in fiscal year 13, we were forced to cancel 7 combat training center rotations and significantly reduce home station training. Although we ensured deploying units were fully trained, sequestration cuts directly impacted the training, readiness, and leader development of more than 2 divisions worth of soldiers. Moreover, in fiscal year 14, even under the temporary relief provided by the BBA, the Army will not be able to train a sufficient number of brigades to meet unforeseen strategic requirements and currently can provide only a limited number of BCTs trained for decisive action. Although readiness levels will increase through this year and in 15, the looming sequestration return in fiscal year 16 will quickly erode these gains. Finally, I'd be remiss if I did not mention the extraordinary burden our civilian employees have faced over the past year with pay rate freezes and furloughs. Although our fiscal year 14 appropriation brought some much-needed relief, I fear we've yet to see the true impacts of these cuts on their morale and on their retention. Looking back, it's been a tumultuous year, but it's still clear now more than ever we must have predictable long-term funding that supports deliberate planning and responsible actions. And for that, we need your help. We need your leadership. On fiscal year 15, budget request reflects the challenging fiscal times in which we live by making the hard strategic choices now. It contains difficult decisions to further reduce end strength, realign our aviation assets, prioritize near-term readiness, and protect soldier and family programs. We do much of this by taking calculated risk in modernization and facilities programs. There's no question, this budget's lean. It could be described as stark, and it's critical to meet the needs of our nation and its soldiers. In this request, we'll begin further reductions to our end strength, reaching 450,000 active, 335,000 Guard, and 195,000 reserve soldiers by the end of fiscal year 17. It's important to note we're also adjusting our force mix in favor of the reserve component. This is the maximum end strength we can afford to protect readiness and the minimum we need to execute the 2012 Defense Strategic Guidance. Nevertheless, this is clearly not without risk. Members, we must restructure our aviation portfolio. We recognize this is controversial, but in our view, there's simply no choice. The money is gone, and we must balance these vital assets in a way that maximizes our readiness and minimizes cost across all components. This initiative will generate savings by reducing our total number of platforms from 7 to 4. We'll divest the older, less capable Kiowa and TH-67 trainers in favor of Apaches and Lakotas. In support, the Guard will transfer their low-density, high-demand Apache attack helicopters to the active Army, and in return, will receive 100 of our most modern Blackhawks, which are ideal for their dual combat and state support role. We'll transfer all active Army Lakota to training mission at Fort Rucker and buy an additional 100 for that fleet. And at current funding levels, the Guard will be able to retain all of its Lakotas. This is the right thing to do. It allows us to better sustain and modernize more capable fleet across all components and significantly reduces sustainment costs. Once again, as an end strength, the vast majority of cuts from aviation, a total of 86%, come from the active Army. Overall, the Guard's fleet will decline by just 8%, while the active force declines by some 23%. At its core, our Army is its people. We are committed to protecting effective soldiers, civilian, and family programs, and where appropriate, adding resources. And in fact, we increased funding by nearly 46% across the myriad of programs associated with Ready and Resilient Campaign. From preservation and prevention of all of our soldier concerns, ending sexual assault and sexual harassment, to suicide prevention, to transition assistance and comprehensive soldier and family fitness, we are determined to meet the needs of our warriors, employees, and their families. We have a sacred covenant with all who serve and all who support them, and we'll do everything within our power not to break that. To protect readiness and support our force structure reductions, we take prudent risk in our research, development, and acquisition of facilities accounts. We've been forced to make significant changes to key programs. For example, we'll conclude the ground combat vehicle program after the technology development phase, as the program is no longer affordable under budget constraints. And instead, we'll focus on modernizing and sustaining legacy systems such as Bradley and Stryker through incremental upgrades. Regarding our facilities, our budget is just 49% of our fiscal year MILCON 14 MILCON appropriation. And we're deferring some 20% of projects across all components, with, again, the majority of those delays coming in the active Army. Let me take a moment to mention BRAC. I know it's not popular. As a member, I had a base in my district closed due to BRAC. It's hard. I know that. But it was necessary then, and it's even more necessary now. Put it simply, we can't afford to pay for the maintenance and upkeep of unused or unnecessary facilities. It wastes money we just don't have. So that is some of the issues that we have before us, my former colleagues. I want to close by again stating how much all of us appreciate all you've done, the relief provided under the balanced budget Act for 14 and 15. But if sequestration, as is the law, returns in 16, our gains will erode, and another round of indiscriminate cuts will gut our force to the point that we'll be unable to meet the strategic guidance. As I opened with, we deeply, perhaps more so than in any other recent time, need your leadership and need your help. This is a time for protection and predictability, not politics. I have been associated with this committee for the better part of 20 years. It has continuously, without interruption, been an honor, as it always is to be with you. And I'd be remiss, Mr. Chairman, as a classmate, if I failed to mention in this, at least for the United States Army, your final posture hearing, how much I've enjoyed your wise guidance, your leadership, and some 21 years of friendship, and I wish you all the best, my friend. Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you very much. General.
Thank you, Chairman McKean, Ranking Member Smith, other distinguished members of the committee. I want to start out where the Secretary left off. I want to thank you, Chairman, for all that you've done for your 22 years here serving, what you've done for the Army and our soldiers. You've been a steadfast leader here in this committee, and we appreciate everything that you've done for us. And we know we'll continue to work with you for several more months, and we look forward to that. Although resources continue to decline, the reality is that the demand for Army forces continues to increase. More than 70,000 U.S. Army soldiers are deployed today on contingency operations, and about 85,000 soldiers are forward stationed in nearly 150 countries, including nearly 20,000 on the Korean Peninsula. As we can consider the future roles and missions of our Army, it's imperative we consider the world as it exists, not as one we wish it to be. The recent headlines alone, Russia's annexation of Crimea, the intractable Syrian civil war, missile launches by North Korea, just to name a few, remind us of the complexity and uncertainty inherent in the international security environment. It demands that we make prudent decisions about the future capability and capacity that we need within our Army. As part of the joint force, the Army deters potential adversaries by being capable of appropriate and rapid response anywhere in the world and across the entire range of military operations, from humanitarian assistance and stability operations to general war. Last year, I testified that we can implement the 2012 Defense Strategic Guidance at moderate risk with an end strength of 490,000 in the active Army, 350,000 in the National Guard, and 202,000 in the U.S. Army Reserve. I stand by that assessment. We will achieve those end strength targets by the end of fiscal year 15. However, the law of the land is sequestration. Therefore, in order to attain the proper balance between end strength, readiness, and modernization by the end of sequestration, we will have to dramatically slash end strength again beginning in fiscal year 16. This is in no way by choice. We will be required to further reduce the active Army end strength to 420,000, reduce the National Guard to 315,000, the U.S. Army Reserve to 185,000. The size of our Army at this level of funding will not allow us to execute the Defense Strategic Guidance, and in my opinion, puts us in doubt our ability to execute even one prolonged, multi-phase, major contingency operation. I also have deep concerns that if the Army goes to the end strength levels required by sequestration, we will not have the appropriate capacity to meet operational commitments and simultaneously train to sustain appropriate readiness levels across the total Army. The President's budget submission supports end strength levels at 440 to 450,000 in the active Army, 335,000 in the Army National Guard, and 195,000 in the U.S. Army Reserve. I believe this should be the absolute floor for end strength reductions. At this level, we can meet the Defense Strategic Guidance, but as we continue to lose end strength, our flexibility deteriorates. My experience tells me that our assumptions on the duration of conflict and requirement about length and size, especially of Phase 4 operations, are optimistic. And if these assumptions are wrong, our risk grows significantly. For the next 3 to 4 years, we are reducing end strength as quickly as possible while still meeting our operational commitments. As we continue to draw down and restructure into a smaller force, the Army will continue to have degraded readiness and extensive modernization program shortfalls. This will cause us to implement a tiered readiness as a bridging strategy. Also, our research development acquisition funding, which has declined 39% since the FY12 budget planning cycle, will continue to suffer. At the end of FY19, under sequestration, we will stabilize our end strength and force structure. The Army will begin to establish the appropriate balance between end strength, readiness, and modernization, a bite for a much smaller Army. From FY20 to FY23, we'd begin achieving our readiness goals and reinvesting in modernization programs to upgrade our aging fleets. Under the President's budget, this will happen 3 to 5 years earlier in FY18 at larger total force levels. In order to meet the reductions imposed by sequestration and achieve the right balance, we have worked for the past 2 years on a total force policy that ensures the proper balance for the active guard and reserve components. In developing our plan, we look to the Secretary of Defense's guidance that we not retain structure at the expense of readiness. Additionally, the Secretary and the Army and I directed that cuts should come disproportionately from the active force before reducing the guard and reserve. Our total force policy was informed by the lessons learned during the last 13 years of war. We considered operational commitments, future requirements, costs, and necessary readiness levels. The result is a plan that recognizes the unique attributes, responsibilities, and complementary nature of these three components, while ensuring our guard and reserves are maintained as an operational and not a strategic reserve. Budget cuts to include full sequestration result in a reduction of 150,000 soldiers, 687 aircraft, and up to 46% of the brigade combat team's reduction from the active Army. The National Guard would be reduced by 43,000 soldiers, 111 aircraft, and up to 22% of its brigade combat teams. And the U.S. Army Reserve were reduced by 20,000 soldiers. The end strength cuts to the active Army represent 70% of the total end strength reductions, compared with 20% from the National Guard and 10% from the U.S. Army Reserve. This results in that the Guard and Reserves will now comprise 54% of the total Army end strength, while the active component will comprise 46%. The Army will be the only service in which the reserve component outnumbers the active component. Under sequestration, we cannot afford our current aviation structure. The budget does not allow us to sustain modernization programs, keep current structure levels, and provide trained and ready aviation crews and units across all three components. Therefore, we've developed an innovative concept to restructure our aviation fleet that will properly address all three of these issues. Overall, we believe this plan will generate a total savings of $12.7 billion over the POM. Of the 798 total aircraft reduced under this plan, 687 of these aircraft comes out of the active component, or 86%, and 111 aircraft, or 14%, from the National Guard. As with end strength, we are disproportionately taking cuts from the active component over the Guard and reserves. Also under this plan, the National Guard will gain 111 UH-60s. Additionally, the National Guard will maintain their current fleet of 212 LUH-72s. The Army National Guard will transfer low-density, high-demand AH-64 Apache helicopters to the active Army, where they will be teamed with unmanned systems for armed reconnaissance role, as well as their traditional attack role. This plan allows us to eliminate obsolete airframes while improving the modernization of our remaining fleet. It will also ensure that we are restructured to sustain an adequate level of pilot proficiency across the entire force. This will result in an active reserve component aviation force mix with better and more capable formations, which are able to respond to contingencies at home and abroad. Let me be very clear. Whether it be end strength, modernization reductions, restructuring of the Army, these are not necessarily cuts we want to take. However, these are cuts we must take based on sequestration. I believe our recommendation delivers the best total Army for the budget allocated. The Secretary and I understand that the American people expect our Army to consistently demonstrate a commitment to our core values and promote ethical leadership. We are aggressively and comprehensively tackling this issue across the board, individually, organizationally, and through systematic reviews. We've initiated 360-degree assessments on all officers, especially commanders. We've implemented a new officer evaluation report, which strengthens accountability. For our general officers, we conduct period surveys, organize 18 annual senior leader seminars, and developed a specific ethics focus as part of our Army Senior Leader Development Program. We continue to make progress on combating sexual assault and harassment, particularly on reporting and investigating these incidents. It remains our top priority. Over the past year, the Army has established more stringent screening criteria and background checks for those serving in positions of trust, expanded the Special Victim Capability Program, and implemented new procedures to enhance private pretrial investigations. Our prosecution and conviction rates continue to increase. But we know that much work remains. We appreciate the continued focus by members of Congress on this issue. We take it very, very seriously. We would also appreciate help from members of this committee with two issues that directly impact our ability to maintain the right balance for our Army. First, the base realignment and closure process is a proven, fair, cost-effective means to address excess installation capacity in our United States Armed Forces. With a reduction of over 200,000 men and women from our Army, we must reduce excess infrastructure. We need BRAC to do this. If not, we will have to pay for the sustainment of unnecessary infrastructure throughout our Army. Second, we are also extremely grateful for the high-quality care and compensation our nation has provided to our soldiers. We have endorsed proposals that we believe continues to recognize the incredible service of our soldiers while helping us to better balance future investments in readiness, modernization, and compensation. We all must keep in mind it is not a matter of if, but when we will deploy our ground force to defend this great nation of ours. We have done it every decade since World War II. It is incumbent on all of us to ensure we have the capacity and capabilities to ensure our soldiers are highly trained, equipped, and organized. If we do not, they will bear the heavy burden of our miscalculations. I'm incredibly proud to wear this uniform, representing the active component, the National Guard, and the U.S. Army Reserve. They have all sacrificed incredibly over the last 12 or 13 years and will continue to incredibly sacrifice into the future. It's incumbent on us to make sure we provide them the tools necessary for them to be successful. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the entire committee for allowing me to testify here today. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, both of you, for your statements. As I said in my opening statement, any suggestion that this budget supports an active duty army of 450,000 soldiers is a smokescreen because it suggests that it assumes that sequestration gets resolved. The fact of the matter is that the Army is, as you've laid out, is heading down a path of 420,000 active duty soldiers or less. General Odierno, my question is twofold. First, based on this budget and an active duty of end strength of 450,000 directed by the OSD, do you still believe that the Army will assume fairly high risk in meeting the defense strategic guidance? And second, if it's a fairly high risk at the 450,000 levels, what level of risk do you assume at the 420,000 level?
Mr. Chairman, as I just stated, at the 440 to 450,000 level, I believe it is significant risk to meet the defense strategic guidance, but we can meet it. And I think that's based on the assumptions that we made. And I think the assumptions are optimistic. I believe that the assumptions of length of warfare, the assumptions on the contribution of our allies, the assumptions on casualties and others are somewhat optimistic, and I believe that increases the risk based on my experience and what we've experienced in the past, that I think the risk is significant. Although I do believe we can meet the defense strategic guidance. At 420, and it's not just the active, it's the reduction in the National Guard and U.S. Army Reserve as well under sequestration that will make it very difficult. As we reduce capacity, we lose flexibility. And therefore, when we lose the flexibility, that means our assumptions must be accurate. And over the years, my experience tells me our assumptions are not always very accurate. And so I'm very concerned that at 420, we cannot meet the defense strategic guidance. I doubt whether we could even execute one prolonged multi-phased operation that is extended over a period of time. And so I have great concern. And what will happen is this, again, falls on the shoulders of our soldiers when this happens, and that's my concern. And as we continue to move forward, the risk increases because as our dependence on OCO is reduced, it also puts additional pressure on the base budget. And there'll be some things that are currently in our OCO budget that have to be translated over to the base budget will continue to increase the risk as we have to execute full sequestration.
When Secretary Hagel and General Dempsey came when we started this process, I think the press picked up on the idea that we were taking the troops down to the Army down to 440,000, and the comment was made that's the lowest level since the start of World War II. I went back, and I think the Army at start of World War II was around 280,000. A year later, after the start with the draft and everybody responding to Pearl Harbor and the things that had happened, the Army went up over 1 million overnight. Well, we know, and I just finished reading a book about the Northern Africa campaign and how many lives were lost and how they were just, we were sending men in just like fodder. They had inadequate training, inadequate equipment, inadequate leadership. And that is something that none of us wants to ever see again. But shortly after that, Korea hit. We did the same thing. And I think all of us here on this committee understand what we've been talking about and how these cuts are so drastic. But I was at an event last week, and there was another member of Congress there, and I was talking about some of these cuts, and he's not on this committee. And afterwards, he came up to me and said he did not realize that we had cut that much. And I think that's, You know, when we come to Congress, we get involved in the committees we get assigned to, and we don't get as involved in other committees and know what's happening in those committees. And still, we're here and we vote on these issues, and we're closer than people I know in my district don't have an understanding of how severe these cuts are, when you're talking about these risks, how severe they are. And yet they see the news, they see Putin going into Crimea, the Russians talking about, on the commentators are wondering, are they gonna go further? Are they gonna go into Ukraine? A few years ago, they went into Georgia, they're still there. And what can we do about it? You know, basically, we're hunkering down. I think, realistically, putting ourselves in a very serious, precarious position moving forward. And I know we pass the budget, and then you have to deal with it as best you can. And if we don't face up to sequestration, and what that means, there are probably people that think that with the budget that we passed in December, we fixed sequestration. We didn't fix it. We put it off for a couple of years, and we got $20 billion back this year instead of 50. But it's something that we really need to face up to, and I appreciate your candidness. I appreciate the efforts that you're making to do the best you can with what you have. But as members of Congress, we're going to have to face up to the real realities that are facing us over the next 8 years. So, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I certainly agree that we need to make sure we have a military that's ready to perform the tasks we ask them to do. I would question, even if we had a million man army perfectly trained, whether or not too many people on this committee would consider it wise for us to use that army to go to, fight a war with Russia over Crimea. The issues there are very, very complicated, and simply sending in the military is not always the solution to our diplomatic problems. But I will completely agree that we need to have that military ready to perform whatever tasks is we think they should perform. I want to ask about base closing, first of all. Do you have an estimate at this point, as you draw down, what percentage of excess basing capacity you have at this point?
Yes. We've done a cursory analysis. We were under a moratorium for a period of time, according to the NDA, that prevented us analyzing. But the figures we show right now is, in the continental United States, approximately 15 to 20% in excess.
Yes. And let me just comment, and I remember the debate. We had a vote in committee on that amendment, which I urged us to strip that out of the NDAA. I sincerely hope this committee doesn't do anything like that again, where we tell you to not even think about planning for what are obvious contingencies, whatever concerns we have about base closing. I mean, the budget reality we have means we need to give you guys flexibility and not box you in like that. So I hope we can avoid that this year. Now, there was an estimate given by Undersecretary Hale over in the Senate that it would cost about $6 billion to implement the BRAC, and then, it would be a $2 billion per year savings. Couple questions about that. First of all, how long would that take? How long would that first $6 billion be going out before we started realizing the savings? And then second, can you, let the committee know how different this BRAC would be from 2005? Because 2005 was really more about realignment than it was about reducing the size of the structure. So frankly, anybody who says, oh gosh, 2005 wound up costing more money, therefore we shouldn't do BRAC, I mean, that's, to call it apples and oranges is an underestimation. But could you elaborate on those two points?
If I could start, and start with your second point, there are really two types of BRAC embedded in 2005. As you noted, Mr. Smith, the actual primary one for the Army was one of moving and consolidating forces, bringing rationality to our command structure, that was not exactly directed primarily at the budget. It did over time produce some savings, both through efficiencies and rational alignments, but it was really intended for us to optimize our structure and make sure we were located in the right places. There was, of course, the second part to eliminate excess capacity. That started a payback more immediately. The $6 billion figure that Secretary Hale used, of course, is a department-wide figure. The Army's right. figure is somewhat less. We would certainly target a net payback of at least $1 billion a year. We generally say a five-year payback. That really depends on particularly environmental considerations that sometimes can stretch out a lot, quite a while. But we would hope for a relatively quick payback, certainly more quickly than occurred in 2005.
Okay. General.
If I just add, in the BRAC of 2005, we did some significant reorganization under that BRAC, which makes that a bit different than this one. For example, the combination of the armor and the infantry school at Fort Benning and others like that, all the logistics out to Fort Lee. So those were major reorganization that was supported by BRAC that made it a little bit more expensive, but now is generating savings for us. The next BRAC wouldn't be quite that drastic. It would really be targeted at just eliminating the excess infrastructure that we have. And so I think you would find it to be not as expensive as it was in 2005 and probably a bit better return, although we are now starting to get big returns on the investments we made in 2005 with the consolidation.
Absolutely. And the final question is, the bulk of the savings that you find in the Army budget in order to meet the cuts that we have described, whether it's just, you know, what FY14 and 15 give you or what sequestration gives you, are in people and aircraft, basically. I mean, I'll throw a figure out. That's like 95% of your savings. Is that accurate? A little bit less than that? Is that?
I would say it's a bit less than that, but okay. It is the preponderance of our savings. I would say up to 70 to 75% of the total savings is on personnel reductions and aircraft reductions, because that's our most expensive operational right. component to buy and sustain over time.
And if you were to be restricted in how you could do that, and I guess the biggest area of complaint is how this impacts the Guard, both in terms of their aircraft and in terms of their personnel, where else would you find the savings? Let's say that we came along and said, gosh, no, you can't do that, and just picking a figure, it's $1 billion, you know, because I think the total aircraft savings over 5 years is $12 billion for the movements that you're making. I don't know off the top of my head what the personnel savings are, but they're significant, I'm sure. Let's say that this committee said, nope, you can't do that, and it was $1 billion. Where would you find $1 billion? And you feel free to just go ahead, check in the pockets of your coat.
Yeah, I was just about to look under the table here. The reality is there are very few places we can go, and they're the very places that we would most prefer not to go. That is further end strength, further modernization program implications, and decreased readiness, which is already severely constrained. I would note, just taking the aircraft, you noted correctly, it's about $13 billion cost across the program. But just the cancellation of the cockpit upgrade and sensor upgrade program for the Kyle, which has already been done, would cost us $1.5 billion. So that money, as I mentioned in my opening comments, as is all the money associated with these compo realignments, is gone. And they're the right. same few accounts remaining that we've already hit hard since beginning in 13.
General.
If I could, the cost avoidance on the aviation restructure is almost $12 billion. That's cost avoidance. And then it saves sustainment costs of $1.1 billion per year.
Okay.
So it's quite significant. $1 billion, you know, is three Army BCTs. So if you have to reduce, you'd have to reduce significant more Army BCTs. It's equivalent to two THAAD batteries. It's equivalent to 2,000 or 1,500 JLTVs, $1 billion. So it would have, we'd have to significantly reduce in many other areas if we're not able to execute this strategy.
In a nutshell, it's training, equipment, and readiness. So basically, you know, you would have a less ready, less equipped, less trained force, which would lead to precisely the vulnerabilities that the chairman talked about that we had prior to World War II and prior to the Korean War.
That's correct.
Thank you very much. I yield back.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Forbes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary General, I want to echo what the chairman said. We're both and all very pleased and fortunate to have both of you in the positions that you're in. We thank you for coming here and sharing your wisdom with us. We learn a great deal from you. We also learn a great deal from the members on this committee and listening to them. And earlier, the ranking member said something that we've heard a lot. He said that the President and Congress came up with a budget and that basically you built a strategy around the budget. My question for you today, is that an accurate statement?
I would never question a member of Congress, particularly a member of the Armed Services Committee.
If I may point a personal privilege here, I believe what I said was that you built a strategy that reflected both the needs and the likely budget.
Well, I'm using my time, and obviously the ranking member has the time he wants to speak.
Yes, and you have the time not to misquote me.
Well, we can look at the transcript, but I think it said very clearly. So it would be fair to say that you did not build your strategy around the budget?
I think it's fair to say that this was a strategy-first development and program. Yes.
So the strategy, it was the first priority, not the budget?
Correct.
Then why in the President's budget, Chairman Dempsey testified before this committee based on the 2012 Defense Strategic Guidance and the budget that had come over based on that if you cut one dime out of that, if we reduce that at all, we could not meet that strategic guidance. Where did you reach this number that came over? Because it's not the current law, it's not what was in the current law, and it's not the dollars that were stated that needed to go to the 2012 strategic guidance. Where did you reach this in-between dollar figure? How did you come up with that?
Chief?
So you outlined 2012 Defense Strategic Guidance. That's the strategy we're developing. I can't speak for Chairman Dempsey, but I'll speak for us. On this budget that the President has submitted, I believe that's the floor, mentioned earlier. I think that's the floor of what we need in order for us to execute this strategy. Once we go below that, we can no longer execute the strategy. We're going to have to develop either amend the current strategy or develop a new strategy, especially as we go down to sequestration. But under the President's budget, I believe we can execute Defense Strategic Guidance with a bit more risk than we could originally.
But, General, it would be fair to say that number is less than what we were saying we needed to meet that strategic guidance last year in the year.
As I said earlier, when I first testified in front of here, I told you for the Army, an end strength was 490, 350, and that's what that would allow us to do it at moderate risk. We're now below that, and so I think we can still execute it, but the risk is increasing.
Good. The other question I have for you, General, last year the Army QDR office sponsored a report that the RAND Corporation conducted entitled Evolving Land-Based Anti-Ship Missiles in the Western Pacific. And it concluded that land-based anti-ship missiles are readily available in the world's arms markets, inexpensive, and able to provide significant additional capabilities to U.S. forces. These capabilities would also significantly complicate the PLA's C2 intelligence and targeting requirements and would raise the risk and cost of a conflict for China. Having such capabilities in the inventory would further U.S. efforts to provide security cooperation assistance to partner nations, could help deter conflict, and could contribute to victory in the future conflict by increasing flexibility and expanding the set of tools available to U.S. commanders to implement plans. My question is, do you agree with that conclusion, and do you see any role for the Army to be able to use these type missiles in the future?
I believe the report is worth us taking a hard look at it, and that we have to, there is a role, I think, for us in our ballistic missile capability to potentially do this. Now, the problem we have now is our ballistic missile capability is overstretched now as it conducts missions around the world. But for us, it is important for us to study this, take a look at it, and determine as we move to the future that this is this a potential strategy we want to invest in.
And final thing is, has anyone at the Pentagon developed, because obviously the devil's always in the detail, the BRAC criteria yet that would be utilized if we had a BRAC?
I'm not aware of it.
We've
done very little on BRAC.
Wouldn't it be fair to say that if we don't even know what the criteria would be, it would be almost impossible to determine what, if any, savings we would have?
Well, I think the issue is we have not been able to do that. What we do know we have is we have excess capacity and excess infrastructure.
So, yes. Good.
And that's problematic.
Thank you, General. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. And, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and gentlemen. It's nice to see you both again. We have worked together on many issues, as you know. John, we miss you over here in the Congress, but I know you're doing a great job over there.
I wish I were back on the committee right at this moment.
Yeah, right. So my issue today goes to the morale and the issues that are affecting our troops, because in particular in the Army, as you know, the real resources are men and women who serve every day, who serve in the reserves, who serve at the National Guard's level. And so I'm a little concerned about the climate, the culture climate, and what's going on within the Army. And you know, we've worked on a lot of these issues together for a long time, General and Mr. Secretary. But when I see things like the situation with the unnamed Brigadier General who's retiring with his current rank despite his various acts of sexual misconduct, and I'm worried about what that's doing from the pressure from the outside to the military structure. And I worry about what happens within the military structure. I have a, you know, son who's committed to the U.S. Army, and I worry about due process from both directions on sexual misconduct, for example. And I'm also worried because I can't think of anything sadder when I look at our military forces than this whole issue of mental illness and the suicide rate that we are seeing. So I guess I want to ask you about what you're seeing, what you're doing, that would give us some confidence that we're going to be able to address what could be low morale because of some of these cuts going on, what could happen because of, you know, what's going on because of these outside pressures and decidedly important, and what we're doing about our young men and women and this high suicide rate that we see going on within our military.
Well, I think you've painted a very accurate brush with respect to the various and myriad of challenges we face, and it takes on many forms, but clearly the impact on morale. The fact that we're going to continue to ask America's sons and daughters to come and serve, to ask America's parents to send those sons and daughters, and we've got to ensure that we retain the confidence and the trust of both those who are serving today and who continue to serve. And as we look at the expanse of issues from suicide to alcohol and drug abuse, et cetera, we're trying to do everything we can to put into place the kinds of rules and regulations that will maintain good order and discipline, but equally important to provide the level and type of care that is necessary. We recently established a ready and resilient campaign. That's an umbrella structure for all of our initiatives focused on mental health, focused on alcohol abuse and those kinds of challenges, some 62 programs, and trying to ensure that we're coordinating those in the most effective way, that we're messaging to soldiers in the right way, and we're trying to get on the, as they say, the military, the left side of the bang, get before the problems actually manifest themselves, because the longer they go unaddressed, the harder they become to be cured. Just yesterday, the Secretary of Defense held a half-day session with all the service chiefs and secretaries, all the combatant commanders, all the top officials from the Office of Secretary of Defense on ethics, on responsibility of senior leaders. We had several national experts come in and talk to us about their experiences, what they believe needs to be done. We need to send the right messages, particularly to junior soldiers who do look at us and watch how we treat senior leaders who are brought before the authorities for various charges and such. So we're working as hard as we can. This is one area, as I mentioned in my opening comments, particularly with respect to family care, that we're going to do everything we can to keep our commitment. And in some areas, we've actually increased funding in spite of the pretty dramatic decreases that many other Army programs have incurred.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Chairman, could I just make a quick comment on that, if you don't mind?
Okay.
Your question is a really important one. I'm spending a majority, the Sergeant Major of the Army and I are spending a majority of our time on this very specific issue that you're talking about. And it's about education, it's about discussion, it's about understanding accountability, it's about enforcing standards, it's about developing an environment that allows our soldiers to continue to grow. And there's a lot of angst for a number of reasons, whether it be jobs going away, whether it be 13 years of combat or 12 years of combat operations. You know, we're spending a lot of time, we're having lots of meetings with our commanders, our general officer commanders, our battalion and brigade commanders, the Sergeant Major is meeting with the senior non-commissioned officers. We're traveling around the Army. And then there's specific things we're doing. We've increased behavior health capabilities. We're increasing our outreach to the Guard and Reserve with behavioral health. We are working this very hard. It is something that we can't stop on, and it's something we have to stay focused on. You're absolutely right, and it's important for us, and we are focused on this issue, and I do appreciate you asking that question. We have to work together on this.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Secretary McHugh, General Orono, thank you for your service. My appreciation of your competence is firsthand. I have four sons who have served under your leadership in Iraq, in Egypt, and Afghanistan. Last year, my wife and I, Roxanne, were reassured by your capabilities as our son, Hunter Wilson, served for a year in Afghanistan, South Carolina National Guard. I'm very concerned about the shifting of spending from national defense to other programs at a time of dangerous worldwide threats. As verified by the American Enterprise Institute, Al-Qaeda is expanding safe havens across North Africa, the Middle East, and Central Asia to attack American families from safe havens. Additionally, sadly, Russia is violating international law by annexing sovereign territory of the Republic of Georgia in Ukraine. We should remember that the despots who have seized the great country of Iran are promoting clearly their goals, signs in English that state death to America, death to Israel. And just 3 weeks ago, there was a ship which had originated in Iran with long-range rockets from Syria, which were being sent to Hamas terrorists at Gaza for obviously an extraordinary attack on Israel. With this in mind, your leadership is more important than ever. General Odierno, the Congressional Defense Committee has directed the Army to explore accelerating the Armored Multipurpose Vehicle, AMV, in each of the last two defense authorizations bill. Now that the Ground Combat Vehicle, GCV, has been terminated officially, can the Army brief the Defense Committees on its plan to accelerate the AMPV program? And further, is AMPV now considered your number one combat vehicle program?
If I could respond,
yes,
Mr. Wilson,
right.
And then the Chief can certainly add. The AMPV is amongst our five strategic requirements. We are very focused on that. As you may be aware, at the moment we have an agency protest, which means that one of the competitive bidders has filed a protest with us that we did not conduct an open competition, and that in essence we kind of wrote the requirements in a way that would favor a particular manufacturer. We need to work through that before we can resume. But AMPV to replace the M1 and M113s are absolutely vital to us, and we intend to, like the Stryker, like the Bradley, and other platforms, continue to fund those and support them.
I would just add is that it's an incredibly important vehicle to us. We're long overdue in replacing the 113. It's critical to our strategy moving forward, and so it's that's why we funded it the way we have in the budget, because of the importance of that vehicle to the future of the Army.
And thank both of you for answering that question, because I know you want the best for our troops, and you've reassured me. General, do you have concerns about the proposed TRICARE changes specifically? Are you concerned how the changes impose cost on active duty soldiers and their families?
So I support the TRICARE change. I think it's important that we go to one system. I think that will save us money and still provide the capability and resources to our soldiers to do this. I believe under the plan, it requires some personal behavior modification by our soldiers, but it still allows them to get the best medical care at the lowest costs. Compensation as a whole, Congressman, is a very difficult issue, because obviously you and us, I want to do what's best for our soldiers and our families. I worry that with budget reductions, we have to just reduce the rate of growth, not reduce the support, but reduce the rate of growth. And we're trying to come up with the best ways to do this. I believe with the TRICARE proposal, we still provide our soldiers with the best medical care possible within reasonable cost. I worry a bit about the potential costs on our lower ranking soldiers, and that's what we're trying to focus on, to reduce that to as small as possible. And we will continue to take a look at that as we move forward.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Secretary, this is very quick, but I've been on the board of the American Lung Association. I'm not pro-tobacco, but at AFES, this generates extraordinary amount of sales, which helps MWR and provides employment for dependents and spouses. What is the policy going to be on tobacco sales?
Mr. Secretary, could you please answer that one for the record? Gentleman's time expired.
Be happy to, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. McIntyre.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks to both you gentlemen for your longstanding commitment to our nation's Army and our nation's armed forces. Mr. Secretary, I couldn't help but think when you said if you're on the committee right now, maybe you'd like to be on the committee right now, what question you would ask yourself.
It'd be easy. Whoever it was.
But thank you for that longstanding commitment and friendship. On page 5 of your testimony, gentlemen, you say, and I quote, "For the next 3 years, as we continue to draw down and restructure into a smaller force, the Army will continue to have degraded readiness and extensive modernization program reductions." And in the next paragraph, you say that under sequestration level spending caps, quote, "The size of our Army at this level of funding will not allow us to execute the defensive strategic guidance and will put in doubt our ability to execute even one prolonged multi-phase major contingency operation." In the time that I have, would either one of you or both, if you would like, explain what this statement of the record means with regard to readiness and with regard to sustainability? Because I think they may be seen a little bit differently. And in fact, specifically, what level of unit readiness does the administration's budget request assume? If funded at the budget request level, how long will it be until we regain sufficient full spectrum readiness and also the ability to sustain a major operation?
Thank you, Congressman. First, with the statement on the 3 years, is the bottom line is it's about the balance. And in order to achieve balance, you got to get down to the right end strength levels. So it's going to, under the president's budget, it'll take us 3 years to get to the end strength levels in order for us to get the end strength right, so we can then start to reinvest in readiness and modernization. And that's when it'll come together. Under the president's budget, we do that earlier. We're able to accomplish that balance around FY18, which then allows us then to start to increase readiness. Readiness is not one time, it's something you have to sustain over the long term. And then that allows us to meet the defense strategic guidance, as we've said, at a significant risk, but we'll be able to meet the defense strategic guidance. Under sequestration, in 16, the cuts are so severe that it will specifically go after readiness and it will take us longer to recover. And when we do finally recover, it'll be in the FY20 to 23 range. But the problem becomes we are now a smaller army. And so the issue becomes, with a smaller army, although it's ready and capable, is it big enough to do right. a prolonged long-term strategy? And that's the concern.
So do you have an idea of how long it would take to reach that level, or does that just remain an open-ended question?
The level of readiness?
To be able to sustain an operation.
Well, again, under the present budget, by 18, I believe, we begin right. to sustain readiness. Under sequestration, it will take about FY23 before we reach that sustainment level, and then we're much smaller as well.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Just a question on that. You said under the president's budget, is that the $115 billion over and above?
That is.
That is kind of just a wish list?
That represents the $115 billion.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. I want to thank both of you for your leadership on the issue of sexual assault, and I want to appreciate the statement that's on page 18 in your joint written comments of our goal is to reduce and ultimately eliminate this crime from our ranks. It is, I think, a huge step forward in the cultural issue that the language of it being a crime is the issue that is emphasized. It takes us obviously to work on legislative and regulatory issues, but it also is a cultural issue, and I appreciate your leadership on that. Mr. Secretary, you have in your joint comments also an issue of suicide prevention. I have reviewed previously DOD reports on the issues of the stress factors affecting suicide, one of which is custody. Unbelievably, throughout our country, family law courts are taking children away from service members based upon either their past deployment or the threat of deployment. I have a bill which has been included in the NDAA for several years that would eliminate deployment as a basis for removal, sole basis of removal. It was endorsed by both Panetta and Gates. You actually voted for it as a member of Congress in fiscal year 08, 09, and 10 for the NDAA.
Thank God.
Our chairman has set it as a goal for fiscal year 15 to make certain this is a law. We've stalled in the Senate largely because of recent weak support from DOD. I'd like the opportunity to sit down and meet with you and discuss this issue and to hopefully gain your advocacy for that. And then my question to both of you concerns sequestration. In your joint statement on page 3, you have a statement I think crystallizes the issue of sequestration. It says the Army continues to face an uncertain fiscal environment in the years ahead. I would like if you would both talk for a moment about the issue of the fiscal cliff that you're facing. You know, Congress looked at it as that we handed you a two-year deal with the budget being certain for 14 and 15. But the fact that you have to cut a glide path through 15 because sequestration appears to return at 16 means that you don't have the certainty even for 15. Now, that's one of the things we're going to struggle with is trying to put money back, but that, of course, places you even in a more difficult position of that fiscal cliff as approaches to 16 without congressional reassurance that sequestration level spending cap in fiscal 16 will not be what you're handed. In looking, General Nero, in your continued efforts to highlight the fact that it would not allow us to do even one prolonged multi-phase major contingency operation if we go to the sequestration numbers. I would like for you both to talk for a moment about this uncertainty, that even for 15, it's not just 16, even for 15, sequestration is putting you in a very untenable position and, of course, is risking, I think, our national defense.
Great question, Mr. Turner, and I don't want to sound ungrateful about the bipartisan budget agreement because it was important relief, and it has allowed us to begin to buy back readiness to increase our CTC rotations, 19 planned for 15, et cetera, or for 14, I should say, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, much needed help. But as you noted, the sequestration is still a law of the land. And absent a definitive act over that term of time by this Congress, it continues to be something we have to program toward. The reason we're talking about 420 is because sequestration will take us to 420. We continue to program for that, although the President's proposal, if adopted, would allow us to sustain the 440 to 450 in the active component we have talked about. The one of the biggest impacts that really extends outside the Army, but obviously affects us, is upon our industrial partners. The folks who look at not just the Army, but all the services as a customer, who need predictability both to do hirings and ensure they've got the right processes in place, got the right plants operating in the right ways. We can't tell them what we're going to be in a position to buy. That makes them less cost efficient. It causes them to hire fewer rather than more people. I mean, at some point, it has a pretty significant drain on the economy, all because of uncertainty, not because of actual economic conditions at the moment. The other thing it does for us in that same avenue is cause us to pay more for things. If we can't enter into longer-term contracts with certainty, it causes us to have to enter into short interim contracts that generally on a piece-by-piece basis cost us far more. So it affects virtually everything we're doing, including, by the way, our ability to recruit and retain soldiers because they're uncertain of what their future will be if they sign on that dotted line. Chief.
General, time has expired. Ms. Davis.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good to see you both. Thank you so much for your extraordinary leadership. Really appreciate it. A few of the questions that I wanted to ask you have been asked, but I might ask them in just a slightly different way. Mr. Secretary, you've been on the other side of the table, and you know in BRAC, as you've mentioned, and certainly General Odinero as well, how difficult these decisions are. But they're important. And what more can you share with us as we move forward and perhaps face that, the question that was faced last year of trying to, you know, rule that out? And I think part of it is the specifics. I think that people do need to know what that means in terms of readiness, quite specifically as you look over this landscape, really, of additional capacity at bases, particularly operations. What more, you know, is there something that is quite convincing you'd like to say about that? And again, particularly from your perspective, Mr. Secretary.
I recognize how hard it was. I was a member for 3 BRAC rounds, and I don't particularly recall enjoying any one of them. But having said that, it is necessary for us to maintain a balance both in terms of the investments we're required to make in support of unnecessary infrastructure. That's going to continue to increase as we draw down our end strength. Obviously, fewer mm-hmm. people mean fewer need for facilities, for buildings, et cetera, et cetera. To maintain an unused building is just the equivalent of throwing money away. The department talks about a $6 billion investment for, say, a 2017 BRAC that they would hope over time, after 7 years, it produced some $3 billion in annual savings. For the Army, $3 billion in annual savings is a lot of money. And our challenge is, as we come down, if we're not allowed to realign our facilities, you start to hollow out. because you start to have fewer and fewer people where the resources are taken away from their more immediate needs and placed into facility sustainment that just continues us down that downward spiral of hollowness and just not doing what we need to do.
Thank you. I've got another question or two, so I appreciate that. I really wanted to hear from you because you've been here and it makes a difference. On the question, I know that my colleagues have talked a little bit about the sexual assault. I mean, one question on that is, how do you fence off outside influences, no matter how you move forward? Because we saw the complexity of that in the latest cases that certainly have made headlines. So that's one question. But the other one, if you could speak to toxic leadership. General, I think you mentioned maybe as we draw down a little bit, that's going to make a difference. How do you really at the bottom deal with that issue?
So we've done several things. And first, it's something that we want to eliminate. And I'll start with the toxic leadership. And so we're doing several things. One is we are doing 360 evaluations. We have done a pilot for battalion and brigade commanders. We're going to probably put that for everyone starting this fall. We are going to move that to non-commissioned officers as well. First of all, that now people are recognizing that we are going to take a look at this and that people are going to see that and that you have to change behavior. It's also about, we repeatedly now have put this inside of all of our training programs, whether it be non-commissioned officer and officer. So it takes time, but what they're going to see is we don't tolerate it. We'll hold people accountable. If you have a toxic leadership environment, you will be held accountable for that environment. And there's several different definitions of what toxic leadership can be, but we are working on all of those. I am meeting regularly with commanders regarding both this and the sexual assault, sexual harassment. We are having a lot of conversations about this. This is about us. This is about us, our leadership in uniform, taking control of this and working the issues in order to solve this problem and create an environment for everyone to excel. So we have to just do that, us. And we have to kind of not worry about what other people are saying. It's incumbent on us to take this responsibility on and do it. And that's the discussion we're having. It's very important that we continue to do this. This is not just something that's passing. This is something that's going to be inherent in what we do as we move forward. And that's the discussion we have to continue to have with our leaders. And they will come around. I'm confident that our more senior leaders have. It's now getting it down to the junior level and making sure they understand that we are serious about this. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And if I may just very, very briefly mention, thank you for the female body armor. That I think we came back from a trip from Afghanistan and pushed for that, and thank you very much.
Gentlelady's time has expired, and by serendipity, as I take the gavel, it's also my turn to ask questions. Mr. Secretary, you've spent an awful lot of time dealing with issues surrounding Arlington National Cemetery, probably something you didn't expect when you walked from here to there. And you and I have had some conversations and exchanges of letters because Arlington National Cemetery isn't the final resting place just for soldiers, but other service members as well. And for some time now, the advisory committee on Arlington National Cemetery has not had any Marine Corps representation, anybody affiliated with the Marine Corps. And so I've asked you to look into that. And can you tell me, are we going to see that anytime soon?
I appreciate your attention to this. And it is important. And oftentimes folks think of Arlington and do think of soldiers. But as you rightly noted, this is the final resting place of all men and women who wore the uniform of this nation. We are very interested in ensuring that all the services are represented effectively and fairly. We, as you know, sir, had a tragic death of the former lady, a terrific lady who was had Marine roots in her background, and we're in the process of making a replacement. I have made a recommendation. The final determination always in these matters rests with the Secretary of Defense. I'm sure he, as well as I, are somewhat frustrated. This is a FACA committee. It has all kinds of procedural requirements. We're at the end of that, and hopefully we'll be able to share a name with you in the very near future.
Thank you. I appreciate your attention to this, and I know it's frustrating in you for us. When you were sitting here, you would never have tolerated a year, year and a half sort of delay, but I do take you at your word, and more than that, I know you very well. You're doing your best to push this through, and it just needs to be resolved. Switching subjects, I want to, since we have both of you here, very quickly talk about readiness and where we are. I think, Mr. Secretary, I think it was you, or maybe General Odierno, but I think you said that with the so-called Ryan Murray budget and the adjustment, you were able to start buying back readiness. And clearly, that's what we'd like to see. I mentioned to you very briefly that I happen to know that at least one of the Army infantry divisions is at a very, very, very low combat readiness state. And when I talked to the commanding general of that division, he told me that he expected it would stay that way for another year and a half or perhaps more. And so I understand that you're having to make trade-offs. The chief is, and you are, in when you look at different units and their readiness. But my question is it your intention to keep that division or any such division, just to keep it down in sort of C4, C5 level as you try to build up the others, or are you going to try to rotate that through?
First off, thank you so much for the question. We are slowly increasing our readiness, but it is slow. I think I said last year two brigades were ready. We're at higher than that now. We're probably closer to five or six. You'll continue to see an increase in that readiness as we invest the dollars we got in 14 in combat training center rotations. So it will increase. The problem is readiness is temporary. It's good for about 6 months to a year. So if with the funding of 14, 50, well, but if it falls again in 16, we're going to go back into this readiness problem again, and we're going to have to sustain a tiered readiness profile, which says we'll only have certain units that will be ready. We will rotate them through the Army force generation process, so it will change between units as we move forward. But that's really the crux of our problem with sequestration, because at 16, we're going to have another readiness dive if it's not changed. We have no choice, because we can't take out the end strength fast enough in order to balance it.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that answer. What I would hate to see is the sort of division equivalent of a hangar queen, yeah, where you just keep them down there for, you know, month after month and year after year. I understand that readiness is temporary, but the nature of this business sometimes is temporary. When you're called now. And so if you're at C2 now, that's where you want to be, not at C4 or C5. I appreciate very much your answer. In a no doubt futile effort to set an example for my colleagues, I will yield back and recognize Ms. Bordaio.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Secretary McHugh and General Odinero, thank you for your testimony and for your service to our great nation. Mr. Secretary, in general, I want to applaud the efforts of the Army working with the Air Force, Transcom, and MDA in deploying the THAAD battery to Guam last year, which, Mr. Secretary, you mentioned in your testimony. The deployment was relatively quick and remained successful. Although Guam had other missile defense assets providing protection, the THAAD is an added defense against North Korea aggression and their threats. And the people of Guam are very supportive of THAAD remaining on the island. But we acknowledge it may have to redeploy if other contingencies arise. So that said, can you comment on efforts to keep the THAAD on Guam and in the coming years? I understand we're looking at a change of the command soon, but what efforts are underway to keep that on Guam for the future? And also, to what extent are you considering utilizing the Guard to support and sustain THAAD on Guam?
I'll start and then turn it over to the chief. First of all, Ms. Mordaglia, I had the chance to visit Guam, visit those troops a number of months ago. They were fresh on the ground, were excited by the mission, and I have to say the Air Force, thankfully, was taking very, very good care of our soldiers during that visit. And I'm sorry I didn't get a chance to meet with you. You were busy doing the job of representing that great island here in Washington. But I did meet with the governor, and your statement that the people of Guam are very supportive was certainly reflected in his enthusiasm. As I'm sure you're aware, That stationing was led by the PACOM commander, Admiral Sam Locklear. He has theater responsibility. We certainly stand ready to provide the mission as he sees fit. This is a very high demand, low density asset. And as you noted, we'll have to make adjustments should contingencies arise. But for the moment, I think we're doing quite well. But Chief,
General, before you start, I just want you to know, Mr. Secretary, that I have taken a couple of CODELs that have visited Guam out to look over the THAAD operation. General,
we are working with the Joint Staff we are at least working to see what it would take to sustain the THAAD battery there for the long term, and we're working with the Air Force. So we're taking it, and we're looking at it from an Army perspective. What would it mean if we had to sustain that there for the long term, in terms of rotational capabilities, the type of THAAD? So we're clearly looking at that mm-hmm. and preparing. If that decision is made that we want to leave it there, the deployment has gone very well. We're very pleased with the support we've gotten there. I know the PACOM commander supports it staying there in Guam. So we are preparing and looking at the options that would allow us to keep it there.
Thank you, General. And I said, what extent are you considering utilizing the Guard to support and sustain THAAD?
Yeah, so what we'll do is, this will be part of our strategy. One of the things one of the options we're looking at, and I'll just throw this out there, is that not buy more equipment, but increase number of crews and capabilities, so you rotate the crews on the equipment. So as we work our way through that, we'll look at all of the components to see how we can solve that problem. But that's one of the solutions we have, because we believe in the future this could be a problem not only if we sustain in Guam, but if we do other deployments around the world. And that's one of the options that we're taking a look at.
Thank you, General. I have another question. I have very little time left. The question is for either of you. I read about the Army-specific pathway strategy in the Washington Post. My staff has had subsequent briefings on the matter, and we appreciate that the Army is trying to articulate its strategy for the Pacific. However, I am concerned that the strategy does not adequately account for the potential of the Army supporting additional missile defense capabilities in the Pacific. It also does not mention or adequately address the capabilities provided by the National Guard State Partnership Program. So I'm concerned this strategy isn't really taking a holistic look at the Army's future in the Pacific. Can you comment on this strategy, its way forward, and some of the items that I discussed?
Yeah, thank you. We are committed to supporting the Asia-Pacific region with our 80,000 active and reserve troops that are there in the region supporting them. Actually, we've funded a 27% increase in the state partnership program in support of PACOM in the budget. So we are looking to expand that program. It is a key program to supporting us. In fact, we are bringing states in to increase our relationship with the countries within the Asia-Pacific region. That's a centerpiece of this strategy. The other centerpiece is that it is the Guard and Reserve have unique capabilities that allow us to continue to engage on several different lines, and that is part of this specific pathway strategy. So I feel confident that as we move forward with this, it has to be a multi-component solution. It cannot just be one component. We need the whole Army involved in solving this problem.
Gentlelady's time has expired.
My time is
Mr.
up.
Rogers.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank both of you for being here. And I also want to thank both of you for making separate but recent trips to the Anniston Army Depot in my district. It was an honor to have each of you there. That installation does an outstanding job of supporting our warfighter, and because of its exceptional work in that role, they're in pretty good shape. And also the mission they play for the military, they're in pretty good shape. But I know the rest of the organic industrial base is not in as good a condition. The question I have for you is, does the Army plan to move any work from the Anniston to facilities with less workload in order to prop them up?
Mr. Rogers, thank you for your comments. I enjoyed very much my trip there, and it was good to get a chance to chat with you. As I'm sure you understand, we are continuously assessing workload distribution across the entire Army organic industrial base, both the depots as well as the arsenals. We have not made any particular particular decisions in that regard, but I have to be frank, particularly as we come back out of theater and once we're through reset, which we, I should add, would require funding for 3 years post-conflict to make sure we're resetting all of the returned equipment. The workloads are going to have to be re-examined and rebalanced. But if that occurs, we'll certainly do everything necessary to keep you informed. Right now, we're in the analysis phase, and we're not prepared to make any announcements in that regard.
Well, we're the Alabama delegation. We're paying a lot of attention, and it's a very cost-efficient facility, and that's one of the reasons they're in good shape. And we hope that money is a big factor in your decision and efficiencies when you decide what to move where, because we think you get a good deal, and the taxpayer gets a good deal at Anniston. My next question has to do with the AMP-V. I'm hearing that there's been some concerns raised about the current RFP that was issued by the Army. In the near future, I'd like to meet with both of you to talk about some of the concerns I have about that. But for this hearing, I'm not really focused on the RFP. I'm focused on the future depot work, maintenance work for the AMP-V. My primary concern is where the vehicles will be built and maintained throughout their life cycle. I believe strongly that it should be the Anniston Army Depot, and here's some reasons why. The AMP-V is intended to replace the M113. Since 1995, the Anniston Army Depot has been the home of life cycle maintenance for the M113 family of vehicles. Secondly, it certainly appears that the AMP-V will be a track vehicle. The Anniston Army Depot is the center of industrial and technical excellence for track vehicles, and that means the track vehicle work is part of Anniston's core workload. And then finally, the model for public-private partnerships for the production and lifecycle maintenance of the Army's land fleets has been the Striker, which is performed at Anniston, and as you know, the Striker has performed well in recent conflicts. Therefore, Anniston has been the best capitalized facility to do the same work for the AMP-V. Given these facts, do you expect the production and lifecycle maintenance for the AMP-V vehicle, the AMP-V fleet, at Anniston, or are you looking to share the work with other facilities within the enterprise? Either one of you.
I'd prefer to have the acquisition executive come speak to you directly, and the biggest part of that reason is, I mentioned earlier, the bid is in an agency protest. That, as you know, severely constrains what we're advised to say publicly about it. You noted, I think, very accurately the advantages and the competitive success that Anniston has demonstrated. If and when we get to that point, which I hope it's if, not when, we'll certainly make the most cost-effective decision we can.
Thank you both very much. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Mr. Courtney, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank, again, both witnesses. It's great to see our former colleague here. And also, General Odierno, that those stripes on your right sleeve are, in my opinion, very powerful evidence of, you know, the fact that every word you present is backed with an outstanding, almost unprecedented level of service in the Middle East. And a number of us had a chance to visit you over the years there. And your commitment to our nation, again, is just unquestioned. Mr. Secretary, you talked in your opening remarks about the sacred covenant that we must have with the people who have served in the Army, and I know both of you believe in that unquestionably. I wanted to share with you a story about an Army National Guard wounded warrior from my district who in 07 was in a rollover. He's 100% medically disabled from a TBI injury that he suffered as a result of it. So he was medically retired. He's still within, obviously, the DOD sort of benefit structure. His TRICARE coverage, which was TRICARE Echo at the time of the injury, became TRICARE Standard once he went into a retired status. If you fast forward a couple of years ahead, he's a young guy. He and his wife had a baby about a year ago. Unfortunately, she was born with a pretty severe disability. It's a condition called short colon, which requires nutrition to be done through feeding tubes. They can't feed normally. And the doctors prescribed about 40 hours of home health services for the care of this child at home. She has to be fed and changed every 2 hours. TRICARE Standard the structure of TRICARE Standard, as I found out, is really patterned after Medicare, so that families with young children and pediatric issues, particularly sort of intensive specialized care, it's a square peg in a round hole. And we have been, for the last 4 months, trying to work with Health Net to try and just figure out some help in the home. We're able to sort of scrape a plan together for 16 hours of care. But again, if you think of the sleep deprivation, if nothing else, that this family experiences with that kind of intensive care, it's not helping the wounded warrior in terms of his issues. And frankly, it just sort of begs the question about how we really take care of these families. Again, TRICARE ECHO, it would not have been an issue at all in terms of getting the full complement of prescribed care that the child's doctors have prescribed. So again, I'm not asking you to answer on the spot here, but I when we talk about restructuring TRICARE, and again, this is a challenge we've got to talk about, as the general said. But frankly, there's gaps, for particularly young medically retired in TRICARE that I'd like to work with both of you to try and fix. I mean, this guy, he did what he was asked to do. He is going to carry this wound for the rest of his life. And his family should not be sort of trapped in this sort of gap in coverage. And again, I'm not asking you to, explicitly, but I just want to make you aware of the fact that, there are these sort of special case problems, right, that I think these conflicts are going to continue to sort of manifest.
Thank you, Joe. First of all, I deeply appreciate the focus and the devotion you brought to this individual soldier, and I know it transcends just a single individual. And you really, I think, struck upon one of the challenges, as you said, will be with us for many years. The good news of Afghanistan, Iraq, is people are surviving the battlefield and wounds that, in all likelihood, they would have never survived before. As many of you have seen, Chief and I certainly have seen many visits to Walter Reed, the challenge is many of those wounds, those survivors, are facing incredibly challenging circumstances physically. I think it's fair to say back in 96 and in 1997, when TRICARE was fully stood up, that no one really considered this aspect of it. As happens in the private insurance industry as well, sometimes you find your needs misaligned with your policy coverages. And we want to certainly do everything we can do to support the activity through the TRICARE Management Activity Center and others to try to close those gaps where they exist. So if there's anything we can do to join in your effort, we certainly stand ready to do that.
Well, thank you, Mr. Secretary. And HealthNet actually is poised to try and work this through to come up with solutions for,
right,
families like the,
right,
Pavlaks.
Right. Well, we have to make sure that we're not placing obstacles in front of them from having that happen.
Right. Yeah. Thank you.
Gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Conaway.
Thank you, Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for being here this morning. And Chief, I want to identify with what Joe said about your long service and the absence from your family all those years. Thank you very much. It seems like a topic that you probably should not have talked about, but based on all the struggles and the stuff that you guys have been putting going forward, I've got to ask you about audit readiness. That Hagel had it in his opening remarks and his written remarks. I did a quick look at your prepared remarks, and I didn't see it there. Accountants and auditors are sensitive little fellows and folks, and when they don't see the chief and the secretary talking favorably about them, or just love them or hate them, just don't ignore them. So I'd like to get from both of you the top-down commitment. I know he's there, but I just need to have it there in the record. But also specifically talk about, as we make this move to GFIBS, which looks like it's moving well and is essential to getting to the auditability part ongoing, there is a tendency to cling to legacy systems because they're the comfortable pair of shoes that you like and feel and you know work. And there's some evidence that you're not making the full move away from the legacy systems, and that while that may help temporarily, it's not going to be the long-term solution. And so can you talk about the process and just give us a general update on where the Army is with respect to meeting the Panetta's original commitment and now the commitment to get audit ready by next year?
Well, I would suggest the reason it wasn't mentioned, we're just simply confident that it's going to happen. We didn't want to...
Well, I appreciate that.
At least that's my story for the moment. As you know, sir, this is something that is not just important, it's stated in law that we have to be auditable by 2017. We believe fully on track to meet that. Our ERPs have been going very well. You mentioned GFIBs. We've had a series of rollouts of those. We're taking them in segmented fashion so that we can ensure that we're managing it in the right way. And to this point, in my discussions with the recently retired Assistant Secretary of the Army for Financial Management and Controller, we're having very, very good success. We're mindful of what you said about the retention of past practices and legacy systems. Perhaps the biggest challenge is to wean people off things and processes in which they have dealt with for years. Even when, say, GFIBs is available, they try to do workarounds and stay with what's familiar. And that's why, in part, we've been segmenting the rollout so we can keep an eye on that and make sure that folks are going the right way. The Chief and I have ordered an analysis and optimization study throughout FMNC to make sure that we're aligning ourselves in cost-efficient and effective ways. I had a brief discussion yesterday with Bob Hale, the DOD controller, about auditability, and we're gonna continue to work toward it. And for the moment, I think all systems are go. Although until we're there, we're not gonna assume anything.
If I could just add, we are taking this very seriously, and I apologize if that didn't come forward. But you know, I speak to every installation commander before they take over, and I provide them a letter of instruction. Part of that letter is a piece on audit readiness and the importance for them to support the efforts that are going on, that the Secretary has really pushed us towards meeting these goals. We're doing mock audits on a regular basis so we understand where we still have some issues. That's helping us to identify where we can improve. We have awareness down really to the lowest levels that this is really important, and by 17, we have to be audit ready. So I'm comfortable that we've identified the problem. I'm comfortable that we're focusing on it. We still have to make sure that we're addressing any of the gaps that we might find as we move forward, but I'm confident that we're heading in the right direction.
As you talked most about the challenges you're having from a budget standpoint and the many places dollars can go, are you able to sustain the necessary resources to do these work as well?
The budget completely reflects the capabilities we need to meet audit readiness by 17.
But thank you both. The music to my ears, and I know the folks who are working really hard at this. This is hard. It's tough stuff. It's not particularly glamorous, and you don't get a lot of medals for it, but it's important for the country. So thank you very much for your service, and appreciate your comments this morning. Yield back.
Thank the gentleman, Ms. Tsongas. You're recognized.
Thank you, General Odierno, Secretary McHugh. It's great to have you appearing before us today. And General Odierno, I do want to thank you for your visit to Massachusetts and to Natick Soldier Systems. It was so much appreciated. So thank you for that. But I'd like to take this opportunity to talk to you both about the decision in the case of General Jeffrey Sinclair. As the record shows, General Sinclair pled guilty to the following: maltreatment of a subordinate, soliciting illicit pictures from junior female officers, possessing pornography, as well as misuse of a credit card, and using derogatory language. He was sentenced to pay a fine of $24,100, but did not receive any jail time or a reduction in rank. I'd like to quote now from a New York Times article that discusses the culture of Sinclair's unit when he was a colonel. The quote is not pretty, and I take no satisfaction from reading it. Quote, "The atmosphere in his unit was such that at a farewell party when he left brigade command 4 years ago, soldiers in his unit put on a skit in which one, dressed in a wig and clothes in an apparent portrayal of the captain the general was sleeping with, acted out a scene in which, quote, she, unquote, asked another soldier, seated in a chair and portraying the then Colonel Sinclair, whether he wanted oral sex," unquote. From this story and from the charges that General Sinclair has admitted to, There can be no doubt that General Sinclair abused and debased his authority in a reprehensible way, using it to perpetuate a toxic military culture which accepted even criminal behavior as the norm. And yet, according to the Times, it was after this incident that he was promoted to Brigadier General. And this is just what we know. I don't want to imagine what we don't know. These series of incidents and its recent shocking outcome, again, in which the general did not receive a reduction in rank and was not sentenced to any time in jail, raises the very serious question of whether the UCMJ can be fairly called an instrument of justice, and whether an organization where rank and the pecking order created by rank can ever rise above the dictates of deference that rank demands in order to meaningfully change. I grew up in an Air Force family of an Air Force colonel, and I recall in the mornings when my father wanted us to get up and do whatever, he always said orders from headquarters, and we responded and did whatever the task of the day was. But to put aside that, this decision and these incidents has undercut the progress that has been made by Congress, the military, and I appreciate the sincere and genuine efforts that the Army has made, and many dedicated advocates, often themselves victims of military sexual trauma, to create accountability and change a culture that too often perpetuates a predatory climate. It fuels a belief within the services and in the civilian world. I can't tell you how many of my constituents commented on the outcome in this case, that high-ranking officers receive and will receive special treatment, whereas enlisted members would be most harshly treated. I know that you both agree that general officers should be held to a higher standard, and there must be serious accountability when they fail to meet these standards. But is that currently possible? I have my doubts. I appreciate that I appreciate the question of Congresswoman Davis about toxic leadership and that you're trying to get a handle on it and create metrics. I hope that that includes a way in which you link toxic culture to the ways in which leaders fuel a culture within their units that promote sexual harassment and sexual assault, all the various forms of military sexual trauma that we've become altogether too familiar with. This is really a comment as much as anything. I appreciate the extraordinary challenges you have. I'm just not sure that you have the tools to really make change. The UCMJ is rooted in an organization that is deferred and defined by rank. It is implemented by those who are ingrained in that culture. And I have to say, this decision was so troubling on so many fronts.
Okay. Thank you, Congressman.
Thanks, the gentlelady. Dr. Fleming.
Mr. Chairman, I think she had a little bit more time left. Oh, she did. I'm sorry. Okay. Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and also thank you, Secretary McHugh and General Odinero, first of all, for your service to our country, both of you in different capacities, and also for being here today. And I listened very carefully to your discussion about the ratcheting down of numbers of soldiers and BCTs, and I want to revisit that a little bit, so I apologize if there's any redundancy. My understanding, we're going from 570,000 to 490,000 soldiers from 45 BCTs to 33 BCTs as a part of the Army 2020 process, and importantly, the remaining BCTs will be reorganized through the addition of a third maneuver battalion and additional engineering capabilities. With the President's FY15 budget submission, we now realize the Army will go even deeper in these cuts. We've already talked about going somewhere between 440 to 450. And should sequestration stay in place, it looks like in FY16 as low as 420. And I think I heard someone actually make the comment that that's really exactly where we're headed at the rate we're going at the present time. Well, I understand a supplemental programmatic environmental assessment is already underway to look at these levels. So here's where I want to drill down. General, can you tell me when each of the remaining BCTs will be reconfigured with the third maneuver battalion?
in the active component, we will complete the reconfigures by the end of FY15. And we will complete, except for two brigades, which will not convert because of room where they're at. So all but two will convert by the end of 15. In the National Guard, we are still working with the National Guard Bureau to define the timeline as they also convert to the new organization, and we're working our way through that.
Okay, thank you, General. Do you, again, General, do you believe you are adequately managing risk by implementing such large reductions, both Army 2020, while simultaneously implementing the supplemental PEA process to yet again look at more cuts?
Well, if I could just make one correction, we're moving from 45 to 32 brigades, not okay. 33. And as I stated, that number of brigades in the active component allows us to meet the defense strategic guidance. But with these additional cuts, depending on how far we go down, if we have to go down all the way to 420, we no longer will be able to, and it'll significantly reduce more the amount of brigade combat teams, up to eight more coming out of the active component.
And based on some comments you said earlier, it sounds like to me if we get down to 420, we're really talking about a high-risk category?
We would not be able to execute the defense strategic guidance, okay. which I puts yes. my concern as high-risk.
Do you see any value in fully executing Army 2020, meeting that commitment to the communities who host your soldiers before you go to the next step with this supplemental PEA?
That's what we're in the process of doing, sir. We want to implement this first.
Right.
We will then, the Secretary and I will then conduct additional assessments on potential future reductions and where that might occur. But we have to continue to, since we know sequestration is the law, we have to continue our process, and that's why we have to do the program environmental assessment right. and get that out there.
And then finally, could you please comment on the potential benefits and cost savings of having a BCT permanently stationed at our National Combat Training Centers?
We currently have one at the JRTC, we have found that to be very helpful to have them there, so they have availability to many readiness and training capabilities that aren't normally there. It's a bit more difficult out at the National Training Center to have one stationed right there. So that's one of the factors we take into consideration as we will make our assessment as we move forward, sir.
Right. JRTC is in my district, and as you know, we're vastly upgrading, enlarging, and because of previous program spending, are really upgrading that and enlarging that base. So obviously we see some real benefits, I think, to the Army in doing that. And I apologize, Secretary McHugh, I didn't ask you any questions yet, but in 30 seconds, do you have anything to add?
You can not ask me a question anytime you want. No, I think the Chief has captured it very well. It all comes back to what both the ranking member and the chairman said in their opening remarks. We're not particularly anxious to take this Army down to 420. We're not at all sanguine about how it would look and the rationality of the process, but it is the law of the land. Unless it changes, that's where we have to go.
Yes. Okay, thank you, and I yield back.
I thank the gentleman, Mr. Garamendi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Representative Tsongas laid out an expose of the Sinclair problem. I understand a few moments ago you talked about a half-day session that the Secretary of Defense had with the ranking members or the rank. My question to you is, so as Secretary of the Army and top general in the Army, what are the two of you going to do about the Sinclair situation?
I'll start. As the final decision maker in matters of this kind, I'm really constrained to what I can say. Unlike in the civilian sector, when a jury comes in and the case is closed, this case is not closed. They're under the Uniform Code of Military Justice, a continuing process of certification of the record, providing both the victim as well as the general an opportunity to respond to the content of that record. The accused can make pleas for clemency, et cetera, et cetera. So we have a ways to go. What I can say is that, as in the civilian sector, We do not have control over, nor do we try to influence the sentencing of a judge. The Army was faced with the prospect of prosecuting this particular individual, and it did that. And it also prosecuted in a way that obtained a conviction. Those are the things we do control. And I think it's worthy to note that in the Army, the prosecution rate for rape is 64%, where in the private sector it's 14%, 14 to 20%. So we do take the steps necessary to hold soldiers accountable. But we cannot, and nor would the civilian sector, be able to make the determinations of a sentencing judge.
So the general gets off the hook?
As I said,
retires with full benefits?
As I said, sir, the process is still ongoing. I have to make the final certifications as to his rank and conditions of retirement, and that's not yet reached my desk.
General, your comments.
I have no additional comments than what the Secretary said. The bottom line is the military justice system, like the civilian justice system, has an independent judiciary. In this case, he had the sole discretion of the sentence and of the accused, and the military judge made a decision. We now will abide by that decision and work through the process as was described by the Secretary of the Army, and we can't comment any further on it because it's still an ongoing case.
When it's completed, I would expect you'll be back here to explain what your decisions are.
Any decision I make will be a matter of public record, of course.
I yield back.
Thank the gentleman, Mr. Gibson.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman, and appreciate the panelists being here today. Thank you very much for your leadership. Appreciate the sacrifices of not only you both and your families, but all those that you command and lead. I'd like to follow up on earlier dialogue with Ms. Sanchez and our panelists about the status of the force, morale, cohesion, professional development, in particular a focus on professional military education. The vision for the Army changes since 2010 when I left it, and particularly if there are aspects of your vision that you would need changes in law.
Right now, I don't think there's any need to have any changes in law, but let me walk through. We understand now that part of what we've learned over the last 10 to 12 years is, and as I look to the future, that the complexity of the environment we're going to have to operate in is increasing. And so one of the great advantages that we have in our Army is our leaders, and we've got to continue to develop them, both non-commissioned officers and officers, in order to meet those increasing challenges. So we are completely revamping how we do training from the United States Military Academy to ROTC all the way up through general officer training that we're doing. We're changing what we do at Command and General Staff College. We're changing what we do at the Army War College. We have NCO 2020 that is looking at the development of our non-commissioned officers and how we continue to train them to understand the complex environment and make decisions. I believe in the future, decision-making is going to be decentralized. And so we have to prepare our young leaders in order to understand this environment and the responsibility of making decentralized decisions, especially with the fast movement of information. So we are totally focused on doing this. It's also about managing talent, and that's one of the most important pieces. And that we want officers that are very well-rounded. We want officers that can be successful tactically, but also understand the broader array of responsibilities that you'll have as you increase in rank, and the responsibilities of running a major organization, of understanding the different aspects of operating in a joint multinational environment, operating, understanding budgets, but also being operationally and tactically proficient. Those are the kind of capabilities we need. So in order to do that, we need to ensure that our young leaders are getting trained to do this and that we manage them in such a way that they're getting jobs that develop them to do and operate across a wide array of responsibilities. So it's a combination of training and education. It's a combination of talent management and utilizing the incredible talent that I believe we have in all the components of the Army.
And Mr. Secretary, any further comments on that?
Well, I think the Chief summed it up very, very well. Obviously, as we go forward, the more uncertain in the environment, we'd like to have our leaders more and more comfortable with uncertainty, and that takes the kind of training processes and the kind of approach that as the Chief said, that it, particularly to his credit, we've worked very, very hard, and we view that as a key to the future.
And as the forces develop leadership, retained and developed, do you envision any potential need to change with personnel policies in terms of right-sizing the force and developing the force?
So I think one of the things we're doing, as we were growing the force in the 2000s, our promotion rates were really high because we lacked the numbers. So as we shape the force as we go forward, first we're going to see promotion rates come down to what I consider to be historic levels, which I think is positive because it's going to generate competition. Competition, there's nothing better than creating great leaders is through competition, and I think we're going to see that as we move forward. And I think that's important. But again, it's also making sure that we continue to have processes both in not only the institutional training piece, but in the operational training, that we provide opportunities for our leaders operationally to think through complex problems. Like, that's why the regionally aligned force concept is so important. It's going to connect them to regions they have not been in before, such as the Asia Pacific, such as Africa, such as working with our NATO allies, such as in other areas, that will allow them to understand the culture, the idiosyncrasies, social economic aspects of what we're going to face in the future, and that's going to be a key component of this. So it's not only the institutional, but it's the organizational and operational education that's going to be important.
And, well, it looks like I'm about out of time, so I'll yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Mr. Barber.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary and General, for being with us today. Before I ask my questions, I just want to comment on an experience I had last week. I had the good fortune under the leadership of Mr. Whitman to go to Afghanistan, where I visited with many of our soldiers who I have to say are performing incredibly well, very professionally, under what I would consider very trying circumstances. I think we all would agree that the statements that have been made by the president of Afghanistan have been outrageous and inappropriate. And I wanted to find out for my own, for myself, how this is affecting morale amongst our troops. And needless to say, morale is very high. They're professionals. They're dedicated to the mission. They're carrying out, as I say, the mission in the midst of very trying and a very fragile situation with the elections coming up just a week or so away. I wanted to, Mr. Secretary, ask you about a particular issue that I joined with Senators Flake and McCain. We sent a letter to you a couple of weeks ago in regard to rumors that the Army Test Evaluation Command, or ATEC, was looking at consolidating test capabilities across the nation. Last year in March 2013, you responded to a similar letter saying that these consolidations were not being considered. But we still hear the rumors, and of course rumors create uncertainty, and we'd like to put them to rest. As you know, Fort Huachuca in my district is home to the Electronic Proving Ground, the EPG. It has capabilities and assets that simply can't be matched anywhere in the country. It's a critical issue for our national security, I believe, that we respond, we get your response to this question. And Mr. Secretary, we look forward to your response and hope that it will be similar to the one you gave about a year ago. Do you have any sense of when we might be able to hear back from you, sir?
That letter is staffed and being worked as we speak. We'll try to expedite that to get it to you as quickly as we possibly can. As I mentioned in my letter last year, capabilities at Huachuca and White Sands offer advantages that are hard to replicate. I can only guess that the source of the rumor probably has something to do with the Army-wide effort we're doing in looking at our administrative structure. We expect that there may be some changes across all Army processes in that regard, so we make sure we're aligned efficiently, but that is a separate issue from testing per se. But I don't want to write the letter before it's written, so let me make sure we're getting you the most up-to-date, accurate information, and we'll do that as quickly as we can.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I appreciate that, and I think as we spoke before the hearing with General as well, I think you know what a unique facility installation garrison we have at Fort Huachuca in terms of the capability it has to test without interference from flyovers or other electronic signals. And I do hope that both of you will be able to come out and visit us in the very near future.
I'm trying. As you and I talked,
I know you
Mr.
Are.
Barber,
you
I've
are.
I've had three trips canceled for a variety of reasons. I'm beginning to think I'm a jinx, but I'm still committed to coming.
Well, we look forward to having you, and I know the community would be very excited to meet with you as well. Let me move quickly then, since I've got very little time left, to a question for General Odierno. I want to thank you, first of all, General, for your incredible service to our country, and it's really unparalleled. General, I agree with Secretary Hagel that cyber warfare should be done one of the DOD's top priorities, and certainly we welcome that. It's the capability we need, certainly going into future warfare. And as I mentioned earlier, Fort Huachuca has the electronic proving ground. It's the Army's premier C5 ISR and developmental tester, with the most pristine electronic range due to its geographic location, quiet electromagnetic spectrum, and no overflights by the aircraft. Because of this, it produces really the best world test results it can have. And any reduction, I believe, in the personnel at Fort Huachuca would put these missions at rest. As the Army looks at downsizing force structure, General, what is the Army's plan to avoid the loss of active duty military and civilians like those that are found at Fort Huachuca who have institutional knowledge to support programs such as cyber warfare? If you could comment, please.
Well first, we're increasing, during this budget downsize, we're increasing our investment. So that's how important it is to us. And so those people and that expertise is critical to us as we move forward and as we continue to expand the Army's role in cyber. And I understand the range that's out there and the importance of that range as we move forward is critical for our evaluation and continued testing. So in my opinion, we are expanding our capability in cyber. We still have some decisions to make, but I think the capability that's in Fort Huachuca is one that's very important to us as we move forward.
Well, thank you both. I'm out of time. Mr. Secretary General, look forward to seeing you in Arizona. I yield back.
The gentleman's time has expired. Thanks, Mr. Barber. Mr. Enyer.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. General Odierno, all the way over here on your right, I've moved positions. Like Mr. Courtney, I recognize what those stripes on your sleeve mean. And I know that over the past dozen years, many in our active component have been on a one-on-one cycle, 1 year overseas, 1 year back to try and reestablish foundry and family foundations, and then it's right back into the fight again. And I realize also, as do you, that if it were not for the contribution of the National Guard, of the Reserve Forces, our Army would have been bent far beyond the ability to sustain that long-term fight. So it greatly concerns me when I heard you talk earlier, and I think it was at least twice that you mentioned the Army's problems in maintaining a prolonged fight if these cuts go through. So that leads me into my question, having set the preface. According to OSD CAPE and the recent Reserve Forces Policy Board study, the National Guard is significantly more cost-effective over its life cycle at approximately one-third of the cost when not mobilized and approximately 80 to 95% of the cost when mobilized. So I'm not sure that I understand why we're proposing to cut the National Guard instead of relying on it more, using a term that you use so frequently, rebalancing, since it offers opportunities to save money while sustaining defense capacity and capability. So I'd like you, and I'll take this answer, since my time is very limited, I'll take this answer in writing after the hearing, but I'd like you to discuss for me why the Army is not choosing to keep tens of thousands of soldiers more in our total Army housed in the National Guard and the Reserves while remaining well inside the current cost constraints. Now, for an answer that I'd like to have on the record, the proposal to transfer the AH-64s, the Apache helicopters, out of the Guard over to the active component, are any of those Guard helicopters going to be mothballed or shrink-wrapped or placed on an inactive status?
The short answer is no, but right, I can get you a General. Detailed answer on that.
Thank you. Now, the reasoning that I've heard propounded here and in other places for this justification for transferring the Apaches is that it's going to save money, but we're not mothballing any, so I'm not quite sure how that saves money. But the other reasoning I've heard is that the governors can get more use out of Blackhawks, that the governors don't have any real use for Apaches. So my question is, has the mission of the National Guard changed? If you use that logic, what you're saying is the Guard is only going to be used for domestic purposes or disaster response. Has there been some shift in policy that Congress has not been made aware of that would eliminate the Guard's role in deploying overseas and in fighting foreign threats as well as guarding against domestic disaster?
Thank you, sir. First, what we're eliminating is almost 600 OH-58 aircraft.
Sir, I'm not talking about the OH-58. I'm asking you specifically about Apaches.
And I'll get to that. But you asked me why we're not mothballing Apaches. It's because we're eliminating OH-58 Deltas. Significant numbers, almost 600, over 600 of those out of the force. That's why we're doing this. Now,
General, I don't want to cut you off. I've only got a minute left, okay. So you can answer that in writing to me, please.
Okay.
Thank you. Now, the motto of the Army that I went through for many, many years was that you train as you fight. And I know when I went to Bill Ingram's retirement ceremony as the director of the Army National Guard, when he gave his retirement speech, he talked about the first unit that got activated out of North Carolina in 2003 for Iraq was the AH-64s. Now, what concerns me is you are eliminating the Army's reserve force of AH-64s at $0 in savings in terms of that program. So I think that is not a particularly wise move, and you are taking away from the Guard's ability to train because they're not going to be able to train as they fight. I have one more comment for you, General, and that is when I was a young officer, there was a well-known motto, different spanks for different ranks. And when I got to be a two-star, I vowed to eliminate that motto in the force that I commanded. And I worked very diligently to do that. In light of the Sinclair episode, I commend that thought to you, to eliminate different spanks for different ranks. Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Enyart. Mr. Glagel. Mr. Glagel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I, looking at some of the issues with respect to the sequester and the budget, I note that the Supplemental Programmatic Environmental Assessment for Fort Bliss, which is located in El Paso, indicates a possible cumulative military and civilian employee loss of 16,000 folks. And the supplemental PEA for Joint Base San Antonio indicates a potential loss of 5,900 military and civilian employees there. San Antonio and El Paso being the ends of the congressional district that I represent, as you know, it's nearly a quarter of Texas in that district. I know that a lot of that, or all of that, relates to the tough decisions with respect to the sequester. But what happens to me as I go home and talk to folks is that the perception is, y'all have such a big budget. Why can't you find the money and save the money and do this and go on about the business of the Army Why is the sequester such a big deal? Can you, if you were talking to folks in El Paso or San Antonio for me, what would you, how would you explain this to them? And because nobody feels the impact of the sequester. I mean, that's just another Washington story, and it doesn't ever really hit home. How would you make it hit home?
Well, first off, thank you for the question. What I would tell everybody is that with all the budget cuts we've had over the last 11 years, it results in a 34% reduction in the Army's budget top line, which is $400 billion over about 11 years. So that's a significant amount of money. And so in order to do that, we have to get in balance readiness, modernization, and end strength. So in order to meet our responsibilities to Congress, it's important that we develop a program that allows us to do that. Unfortunately, that means we have to reduce the size of the Army, because the one thing we don't ever want to do is send people into harm's way that aren't trained or have the most modern equipment. So we got to balance that. And that's the cost, is that we are reducing our spending on defense. That means we have a smaller Army. That means there'll be one that can do less. But in order to make it and continue it to be capable, we have to reduce it. And that's why these reductions have to take place. Now, we can have an argument over whether it's too small or not, but the bottom line is, with the dollars that we've been allocated, we have no other choice. That's the only thing that we can do, and that's what I would say to them.
Is the sequester then not impacting readiness in the sense that if you're going to just field a smaller Army, your smaller Army will be ready? But I would argue that sequester impacts the training, for example. It impacts, it has a real impact on the safety of our men and women in uniform.
It does in the interim. So in other words, for 5 or 6 years, as you're building, it all has to do with, as you're taking end strength out, you then don't have enough readiness. But once you get that end strength out, we'll be able to sustain a readiness level that's appropriate. And that's the end state. And so at the end state, you have a smaller Army that's ready. But in the meantime, it creates great uncertainty and unreadiness, because we have to be very careful on how we take soldiers out of the Army. We want to make sure we can still meet our current operational commitments. We want to make sure we take care of our soldiers as we take them out. And we're taking out nearly 20,000 a year now out of the Army. And for us to get down to sequestration levels, we would have to continue that for another 5 years.
Well, I would invite you. I know that you've been, and I know that you've been semi-frequently, and Mr. Secretary, you as well, to visit both Fort Bliss and Joint Base San Antonio. I think they're significantly important in national defense. Each obviously has a very different mission, the San Antonio mission with the medical corps and the medical training for across the services. But I would like the opportunity to host y'all and have y'all talk to some of the folks directly about the importance of their mission and some of the challenges that you all face in the day-to-day decision making with respect to these making these numbers work.
I'm actually coming down in April to San Antonio, so I'd be happy to set something up.
Great, thank you.
Gentleman yields back, Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for your service. And I was with General Welsh this past weekend at Moody Air Force Base, where the A-10 flies out of, and I have a tremendous amount of respect for General Welsh, and know that he, like you, is having to make a tremendous amount of tough decisions. With regard to the A-10, my primary concern with the recommendation is that we are pulling down that weapon system over the course of 24 months, when it will be 7 to 8 years before the F-35 is coming off the assembly line in adequate numbers to replace some of the other planes that are going to be stood down. I recognize the F-35 is not the primary to take the role of place of the A-10 for close air support, but we can't have one plane in two places at the same time. So we're going to be pulling down a lot of planes over the course of the next 24 months. With regard to the close air support mission, that's obviously going to be taken over by other weapon systems. And my question gets back to, with the retirement of the A-10, the cost of flying the Apaches, what additional cost do you expect to incur out of the Army's budget in handling that close air support mission with Apaches instead of the A-10s? and what additional challenges, whether it be in altitude or range or other areas, do you anticipate A-10 versus Apache?
Well, first, I think, first I want to tell you the A-10, the soldiers appreciate the A-10 and the incredible support it's given to us. It's considered to be an incredible, good, close air support capability. What I would say, though, is the replacement really in the interim is the F-16. The F-16 is going to be what gives us close air support. We've been using the F-16 for close air support in Afghanistan. They've done about 60% of the missions in Afghanistan in close air support. I think what we have to do with the Air Force, though, is work through the tactics, techniques, and procedures on how we continue to move forward with the F-16 providing close air support. The Apache provides some support to our ground troops. It provides us close, tactical, integrated air support, but it does not replace the responsibility and the need for close air support from the Air Force. Mm. And so we're going to have to depend on the F-16 until the F-35 comes on board for close air support. Again, as I said, they've been providing that with that in Afghanistan in some cases. We need to work with them to develop the proper tactics, techniques, and procedures so we can move forward. And General Welch and I have talked about this.
Yeah. Well, as I said, I have a tremendous amount of respect for both of you. And I know he was an A-10 pilot. And I know that if we weren't in the budget situation that we're in, we wouldn't be talking about retiring over the course of 24 months. It would probably be closer to a 7-year or an 8-year drawdown as they went in for major depot maintenance. But I appreciate your service, and look forward to making sure that we maintain that close air support mission, as I know you and General Welch will work on as well. Secretary McHugh, thank you for being here. Sorry I had to step out for a little while, but thank you for your service. With that, I yield the remainder of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Ms. Spear.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. And to both Secretary and General, you've led this country during some extraordinary times, and we value all of your sacrifices on our behalf. Secretary McHugh, I must challenge your earlier statement to say that there are 5,000 soldiers who will file complaints for sexual assault or rape a year, and only 500 of them go to court-martial. That means that only 10% of those that file complaints actually go to court-martial. What happens to the 90% that don't? So the record is good in terms of once they get to court-martial that you are successful, but that doesn't address the fact that so many of these cases go unaddressed. But that's not really what I want to spend time talking about this morning. General Sinclair pled guilty. He pled guilty to engaging in an inappropriate relationship with his accuser. He pled guilty for engaging in an inappropriate relationship with another female Army captain. He pled guilty to engaging in an inappropriate relationship with a female Army major. He pled guilty to possessing and displaying pornographic images and videos on his computer in Afghanistan. He pled guilty to using his government-issued travel card for personal purposes for a trip to Tucson, Arizona, to see his accuser. And he pled guilty to using that same travel card for another trip to see her in Fort Hood, Texas. He pled guilty to engaging in sexually explicit communications with a second female captain. He pled guilty to engaging in sexually explicit communications with a female major by requesting and receiving nude photos and a sexually explicit video of her. He pled guilty to trying to start an inappropriate relationship with an Army lieutenant. This is a sexual predator. And for a sexual predator to gain the rank that he has gained, go through a court-martial process, and be given a slap on the wrist suggests to everyone who's been watching this case that it does not work. The system does not work. This is an issue of undue command influence. That is the problem. It's a problem when undue command influence does not move forward in terms of investigations and prosecutions, and it is a problem when undue command influence goes forward in a case that's got problems. Now, it is true that the defendant and the prosecution had come to an agreement
a pretrial agreement in which the defendant agreed to a demotion and jail time. And it was the convening authority that refused to accept that plea. Now, my understanding is that you have the authority to demote General Sinclair. Is that not the case?
Under the processes for the military, when a soldier goes for retirement, the Secretary of the Department has the authority to order a grade determination board. And that grade determination board makes recommendations as to the grade at retirement for that officer. That's correct.
So let's be clear that this general pled guilty to any number of egregious conduct that a lower-ranking individual would have been kicked out of the military. He has pled guilty to those, and you do have the authority to demote him by virtue of being the Secretary of the Army.
As I said, under the military procedures at retirement, the service secretary of any of the military departments can order a grade determination board to make recommendations on grade at retirement.
Are you going to order that grade determination board?
As I stated earlier, Congresswoman, as the decision authority in those matters, I am...
You're not at liberty to tell us.
I'm not at liberty to make comment on what I may or may not do, particularly given that the case is still technically open under the UCMJ. Unlike in most civilian courts, there's a preparation of the trial record. The victim in this case will be allowed to make comment on those kinds of things. The accused can make clemency pleadings, et cetera, et cetera. So I regret, but I'm highly constrained from what I can say.
All right.
I can say, though, as I did earlier, as I know you appreciate, and we all appreciate your devotion and focus on this very important issue, the Army only had control over whether or not this officer was prosecuted. He was. Those guilty pleas that you mentioned came about because of the Army did prosecute. We in the military, like in the civilian sector, have an independent judiciary, and the independent judges make determinations of sentencing. This officer was convicted.
The judges, though, it's important to point out, thank you, Secretary, are JAG officers that play the role of a judge for a particular case. So they are still subject to the chain of command in subsequent cases. I yield back.
Gentlewoman yields back. Mr. Carson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Secretary McHugh and General O'Dinero, for your service to our country. General, let me first start by saying I have a deep affection and admiration toward you for two reasons. One is substantive, the other is superficial. On the substantive part, I spent some time with you in the region a couple of years ago, and I found you to be very forthright, very knowledgeable, and greatly respected by your team and by our men and women in uniform. On the superficial side, I think you carry yourself quite well for a fellow tall guy and a guy who has a similar haircut, so thank you. Secretary McHugh, I recently received word about an Army proposal to pull some of its financial management services in-house and away from the Defense Finance and Accounting Services. And as you may know, if you don't know, in Indianapolis, Indiana, which is my district, DFAS headquarters is located there. And obviously, this is a deeply serious concern, for that matter, for me and my constituents who might have been impacted by these changes. But before getting to my question, I just want to say, sir, and you can relate as a former member, that I'm disappointed that the Army didn't reach out to me with the details of the proposal, and I had to receive the information third party. So I know you understand my concerns because you've been on this side as well. But I would like to know from you, when I learned in March that an Army pilot project is set to begin in April, there really wasn't much time to properly make an inquiry and determine how exactly this will impact my district and DFAS as a whole. I don't know, you've probably seen the letter from the entire delegation of Indiana with several questions about this proposal, its impact on our state, and how it might impact cost effectiveness and auditability of the Army. So I hope I can get your commitment to provide some answers before the general pilot program begins. So here are my questions, sir. Can you tell me if the Army is currently proceeding with a plan to realign some of its financial management and accounting services, whether through the proposal I'm referencing or for some other proposal? And what are your goals, sir, in this process, and how will efficacy and feasibility of a proposal be judged beyond the pilot stage as we know it today?
Thank you, Congressman. First of all, as I know you understand, the United States Army does not control DFAS. That's under the Department of Defense, principally the controller at the moment, Secretary Bob Hale. I, in fact, had a conversation with him about this matter, a very brief one, yesterday. And obviously, as the administrative head of DFAS, he's tracking very closely what, if any, impact the Army's current initiatives may have on DFAS. And I want to underscore the word, if any. Our intent is not to have an effect one way or another on DFAS, but rather to optimize our financial management and financial structure internally. The project that you're, I believe, referencing is a two-based pilot program that, by and large, focuses on internal management and internal Army financial structures. And we don't expect it would have much of any impact on DFAS, whether it be in your district or whether it be not far from my district. It used to be in New York and Rome, New York, for example. But we won't know what the outcomes may be until we do this one or two-based targeted program. I think everybody has to be realistic, though, that DFAS relies upon its customers, and its customers are the Army, the Navy, the Marine Corps, the Air Force, the Coast Guard. As the number of customers get smaller, you're going to have fewer transactions if no one does anything else. It's just realistic. So, I mean, the face of DFAS, I would think, and it's not my call, would have to make some adjustments to accommodate the drawdown on the budget as well. It seems to me logical. But having said that, the last point I would make, much of what we are doing is in pursuit of what Congress has legally said we must do, and that is to become auditable. We've launched, you may have heard our conversation earlier, Mr. Conaway, launched GFIBs and other ERPs to make sure that we are auditable. Part of that, too, will yield in efficiencies and economies that may at some point have a transactional, an effect on the transactions with DFAS. But we have to make those validations. And I know we're working the response to you and your delegation's letters so that, you know, our intent is not to surprise anyone. But again, this is basically an Army-focused exercise. But it does have the Controller General of the Department's attention.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. This concludes questions from members. Offer the Army leadership any final comments.
It's good to see a fellow New Yorker. Go Yankees. Thank you, sir.
No, thank you very much, sir. Appreciate it.
Well, we thank the panelists for their long, distinguished careers, for their service, and for their testimony here today. And may God bless the United States Army. The hearing is completed.